And a new video on apologetics again this time. You see, I promised in my last video to show you a bit of our road here in the countryside of Madagascar. So stay tuned, because I will paste some of that footage at the end of this video. Anyway, let's get started. I grew up in a time that knew wonderful developments, from loading my video games with a cassette up to the first decent-sized mobile phone. When I got a little older, I attended the still illegal house parties where many Dutch DJs started their career. So much fun, so much amazing things to find out. And of course, I knew that people could do bad things. I mean, I myself have been beaten up one time while one of the two boys held a knife to my throat. And honestly, that wasn't very nice. But other than that, I did not feel that we are living in a fallen world. Somewhere in 1994, I became Christian. I recognized that even though I still didn't realize half of it, I needed a savior. I lived my life, I got married, went to Bible school, and later studied theology at the university in the UK. And yes, by that time I was aware of all the bad things going on in the world. I mean, I'm not that naive. But then it happened. I had to choose a subject for an essay on ethics. And yes, I just had to choose the subject on abortion. I wrote that essay in no time, but it felt like an eternity. I struggled, I cried. I actually became like the grumpy and angry atheist I used to debate. What happened? All of a sudden, God showed me how low humans can go. He showed me how depraved creation has become. But was this just me? Can I really say it is wrong to kill innocent children? Who determines right from wrong anyway? Many Christians use the moral argument to prove the existence of God. But to offer a moral argument for the existence of God, we must establish the existence of objective moral reality and show that a personal and moral God is the best explanation for the existence and knowledge of objective moral reality. We will do that in a moment. First, we need to get rid of some of the fallacies that circulate on the web. Atheists often claim that they can be moral without believing in God. Therefore, religion is not needed for morality. And I hope you'll see the red herring here. The argument from objective morality to God is totally not related to this issue. In reality, a Christian should admit that non-Christians, including atheists, possess and act in line with true moral principles to some extent. Romans 2 verse 14 and 15 says this: "For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves, which shew the work of the law written in their hearts, the conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts the mean by, while accusing or else excusing one another." So this argument is totally beside the point and completely off topic. Because the moral argument for God addresses the metaphysical foundation of goodness. Or in other words, it tackles the question of where the absolute starting point for morality lies. Okay. Another red herring is this one. Some claim that God cannot be the source of morality since unbelievers use moral words like good, right, and wrong, without pointing to God's will to explain these words. This is also irrelevant to the argument. The moral argument has nothing to do with how people typically use or define moral terms. Instead, it addresses the justification of moral claims. An unbeliever may realize that rape is morally wrong without knowing the real reason why rape is wrong. A German, Gottlieb Frege, gave an example to understand this a little bit better. He said, "The evening star and the morning star appear at different times of the day and so have different senses. However, they are the same star. The reverend is identical even if the senses are different. So likewise, an unbeliever may have an idea about the meaning of morality, yet fail to realize that the ultimate referent for morality is God's character and will. Okay, but we're not ready to explain the argument yet. No, we need to look at a phenomenon called moral relativism. You see that what is good for you isn't necessarily good for me. Yet others will say that the moral standard depends on one's culture. In the past, some cultures and groups deemed it okay for old, unproductive people to walk off into the wilderness and freeze to death. In times of famine, the villagers may decide to get rid of the extra load on resources caused by the old and disabled people. That way, they are not a burden for the family. Oh well, that was just their morality, right? And it was perfectly fine to act like that in their specific situation, right? Well, I do not want to go down this rabbit trail, and there is so much to say about moral relativism. You see, it's a huge swamp in which nobody really knows what is right or wrong. But look at it this way. If relativism is true, then rape is not always wrong, since a culture or an individual might allow for it under certain circumstances. However, rape is always wrong, and that means that relativism is false. Or, for example, what to think about Stalin's planned famine in 1932 and 33, by which he killed at least 6 million peasants, but some even suggest 12 million, mostly Ukrainian farmers, in order to punish resistance to the communist system. In June 1933, at the height of the famine, 28,000 men, women and children in Ukraine were dying of starvation each day. This planned famine is called Holodomor, or Holodomor, I don't know how to pronounce it, Holodomor. And up until today, many still refuse to recognize this as an act of genocide. This punishing of the resistance killed so many people that this event can actually easily compete with the Holocaust, which is accepted by most as genocide. Our immediate response to such an event should be deep moral revulsion. Not something like, well, it's not something I would do, but I cannot judge others because they lived in a different culture and in a different time. The profound moral loathing normally evoked by such events presupposes an objective moral standard that has been transgressed. And I guess the answers on these two examples I just mentioned beg the question whether there is an absolute moral standard or not. I will not further go into this typical anti-intellectual viewpoint of relativism. It is a worldview that cannot consistently exist within its own rules. This worldview mostly ends in a nihilistic worldview. A German philosopher Stirner stated this: "You think that the good cause may be my concern? What's good? What's bad? Why, I myself am my concern, and I am neither good nor bad. Neither has meaning for me. Nothing is more to me than myself. Nothing around you matters. It is all neither good nor evil, neither cruel nor kind, but simply callous, indifferent to all suffering, lacking all purpose. Thus saith Mr. Dawkins." Okay, so I do not deny that moral principles may be applied a little bit different from time to time. There is a difference between a deep moral principle and the application of that principle in a moral rule. The Bible teaches that it is an objective and absolute moral principle that God should be worshipped, for example. But the moral rule as how to worship God changed over time. In the Old Testament, we have had the sacrificial system, and in the New Testament, it is Christ who fulfills the sacrifices. So, ethical and moral relativism is absolutely false. So now we have to deal with an objective moral system of some kind. How can we best explain the existence of an objective moral system? I say that a personal and moral God provides the best explanation for the existence of the moral values known to human beings. But just saying that would be a bit easy to do, so let's expand a little bit more. Okay, so if torturing children for fun is unconditionally evil, and if the heroic actions of firefighters who, with risk of their own life, save people from a certain death are unconditionally good, we need to propose a worldview that accounts for the origin, existence and knowledge of such good and such evil. The proposed worldview also needs to provide us enough moral motivation to pursue good and oppose evil. The simple argument for from goodness to deity goes as follows. If a personal God does not exist, then objective moral values do not exist. 2. Objective morals and moral values do exist. And 3. Therefore, a personal God exists. Some argue that this idea of a deity is easy interchangeable with ideas like Hinduism. The creed of one influential school of Hinduism states that Atman is Brahman. The individual self, Atman, is identical to Brahman, the impersonal and amoral universe. In other words, there is no difference between the creator and the creation. In Hinduism, there is no creator who is personal, a personal and moral agent who brought the universe into existence. If, like in Hinduism, all is one, then there is no room for diversity. Even in morality, there are no objective moral values. Yet others might propose that Allah, the God of Islam, is this being. You see, this is one of the problems you'll have to face when dealing with arguments like this. People flippantly say that your argument can point to a variety of deities. This, of course, can only be done if there is no knowledge of all the other theistic arguments. We are still talking about a perfect being. A perfect being, and it cannot be just some other deity from any other religion than Christianity. You see, Allah doesn't even come close to the God of the Bible, Yahweh. I have demonstrated this, for example, in the video on the ontological argument. If God is perfect, then we know for sure that he cares about his creation, because he is perfect. And he will reach out to his creation in one way or another. Also, for example, the idea of the Trinity is supported by the ontological argument, because a perfect and all-loving being needs to have something to love outside his own creation. And the Trinity is also guaranteed to us in the Bible. So we have a very strong rational indication to believe the stories in the Bible about God who came to live among us in the person of Jesus Christ because he wanted to save us. And so the circle is complete. You start with a daunting philosophical argument and you end up with a bulletproof rational reasoning that the Bible actually tells you the truth. Don't you just love it? So it is easy to come up with all sorts of evil that we expect everybody to condemn, and I will not give more examples than I already did. Whenever you encounter someone who says that morals are relative or flexible, thus totally depending on human ideas, you can ask them what they think of the evils done by humans. If the person is honest, he or she will abide by his or her idea. In that case, you can always ask whether he or she would stop a person who wants to molest a child, or even if this child is his or her own child. Why should they stop such a person? For all we know, there is no such thing as absolute right and wrongs. So, if there is no God, then morality and law lose their foundations and there is no objective good and evil. But there is good, objective good and evil. Therefore, A, it is false that morality and law have no ultimate foundations and that there is no objective good or evil. 4. therefore be God exists as the ultimate evaluator. Or simply put, either God exists, who provides the ultimate moral evaluation, or nihilism is true and all moral evaluations are arbitrary. Nihilism is false because there is objective good and evil. Therefore, God exists as the ultimate moral evaluator. The British philosopher Hastings Restall said that if we believe in an objective and absolute moral order, we must logically believe in God as well. A moral idea can exist only in a mind from which all reality is derived. Our moral ideal can only claim objective validity insofar as it can rationally be regarded as the revelation of a moral ideal eternally existing in the mind of God. Okay, finally, I would like to address another counter-argument, which is also known as the Euthypro, I don't know how to pronounce it. This problem was first raised by Plato in Euthypro. This argument goes as follows. Number one, if something is good because God wills it good, God could goodwill anything, even rape or murder, and it would be ipso facto good. But this is absurd. Number two, if God's will is not the source of good, goodness lies outside of God's being, and it robs him of his moral supremacy, which is an essential attribute of deity. This dilemma seems very smart and sound and so on, and the critic might think he or she debunked the moral argument. But alas, this argument has been built on a strawman fallacy and it creates a false dilemma. The triune God, as I argued for in my previous video, who has existed from eternity in a threefold loving relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, cannot, for example, morally mandate murder or rape. God's attribute of mind disallows it. God's integrity execrates it. The Bible shows that objective moral values are not created in the same sense as the universe was created out of nothing. No, objective moral values have always been part of who God is. They have their source in the eternal character, nature, and substance of a loving, just, and self-sufficient God. God is not created. He has always been there. Likewise, moral values were not created but are eternally part of his being. So for that reason, when God creates humans in his own image and likeness, they need to know objective moral value, and they must treat each other accordingly. And this is exactly what the Bible teaches in Romans, where Paul says that the law has been written in our hearts. We know right from wrong because we are created in God's image and likeness. So, one more time. Number one, if God does not exist, there are no moral obligations. Number two, there are moral obligations to parents, to children, to fellow citizens, to the truth itself, and so on, which are more than socially constructed, which is relativism. So number three, therefore God exists as the source of moral obligations. Good, this was the video for now. This was the moral argument. I think it's a little bit longer than usual, but there was so much to say. Anyway, please look at the description of this video. Whenever I find or use some interesting links, I'll link it there. You can also find ways to support me. And yeah, it's very encouraging to receive gifts, so no matter how small. For me, that's a sign that you actually enjoy my videos. Well, it's one of the signs, because another sign is also when you're commenting on my videos. I really appreciate that. Talking about commenting, you may comment on my video on BitChute or YouTube, but you most likely won't receive a reply there because I'm mostly active on Odyssey. I would like to invite you to my Odyssey channel. Odyssey is a platform which is based on a new protocol called Library, and it's censorship free. unlike YouTube or others. It would be great if you start following me there, but you can also start your own channel on Odyssey, and if you use my invitation, which you can find in the description as well, we will both receive some free LBC. So, as always, thank you for watching, God bless you, and we see each other in the next video. Okay, let's enjoy some off-roading, shall we? As promised, here is the short compilation of the last bit of our road. It is hard to see all the bumps and potholes, but I think you can imagine by seeing the camera going up and down. Here we go. So it's as promised, I will take some shots from the road. We actually really live at the end of this road. So there you'll see the bigger road, what they call Route Nationale, which we have traveled on. And then we need to go off the main road and then travel on this road. And while we're going, I will try to record a little bit, because this is still nice to see. This is still, well, not really bad, but there are some parts that are really bad. And it has been raining, not too much, I believe, so it should be doable. First thing I'm gonna do is turn on the hub locks so I can drive in 4x4. Here I go. So these are the hub locks. I put them on lock so that I will have 4x4. And then we're ready to go. There you go. Kids all have had a break, and we're ready to go. So here we are entering the first village of our area. It's a somewhat bigger village because it's still pretty easy to come here by a car or even by a truck. And then in the next part, you can't really see it with the camera, but I have to drive through some tracks which are made by a truck. And on the left side, I try to avoid that part of the road. The tracks are really, really deep, so I try to steer on the right, but what you can't see on the video is that the back of the car is slipping into one of those tracks. So we're now entering the biggest village of our area, called Sandrui, and you'll see that I have to do some decent climbing and descending with the car. The road is bad. There are a lot of channels on the road formed by heavy rainfall, so it's a challenge. But the good thing is that the road here was pretty dry this time. Okay, and this is the last part of the road, which is directly leading us to our house. Actually, here my wife took over the camera as it was tricky going downhill. It had been raining earlier and that always makes this part very slippery. You'll hear us say in just a moment that the camera doesn't show it, but the car is constantly slipping diagonal.
De camera zie je dat niet zo heel erg als je aan de slip raakt.
Nee. Maar we voelen het wel.
Ik vind het zo pijnlijk. Ik voel het
even. And what do you know? There you'll see my lovely office. So we have returned home. As you can see, we already unpacked the car. All the luggage is on the veranda. And what I'm now the last thing I'm gonna do now is turning the car around so that whenever we need the car in a hurry, we don't have to turn, because it's quite hard to turn the car here. It's quite steep. As you can see, this is the road where what I said, this is the end of the road, and it's quite steep. It's and slippery, especially because it has been raining. So yeah, so let's see whether I can turn the car.